Weed. It's basically everywhere you look, and it is by far the most popular recreational drug, with its use particularly high among young people, though it is extremely popular among all age groups, of course. The expectation is that cannabis will only get more popular as it becomes legal in more places, and loses a lot of the stigma that has been attached to it in the past, and that this will eventually make it more accessible. But this worries some scientists and healthcare professionals who are concerned about the effects that cannabis may have on cognition if consumed during one's adolescent years. For example, a lot of people who smoked a lot of marijuana during their lives will tell you that their memory is not what it used to be. Adolescent brains are of course very special, not only because of their special ability to find the most perverse way to ruin the rest of society for us, but because they are of course still very much developing. And it is believed that because of this, because adolescent brains are still very much developing, they could be more susceptible to harm than adult brains, and that consuming marijuana during one's adolescent years could have a detrimental impact on one's long-term intelligence. An idea that is not nearly as crazy as it initially sounds. After all, a number of studies have demonstrated that cannabis use during youth is associated with reduced educational attainment, quality of employment, and relationship satisfaction. In fact, one robust scientific finding is how frequent marijuana use has a habit of leading to memory impairment in the long run. And the 2013 meta-analysis identified reduced gray matter on MRI in the hippocampus and amygdala, which was highly associated with frequent or dependent cannabis use. My name is Hesham, and I'm a University of Cambridge graduate and student doctor, and this is Doctor Tell Me Why. If you're new here, then just know that this is everyone's favorite science channel. And today on everyone's favorite channel, we will be looking at cannabis use during adolescence and its effect on later life IQ, a metric that's commonly used to gauge intelligence. In other words, we will try and answer the question that is keeping up millions of parents up at night: does frequent cannabis use during adolescence lead to a decline in IQ? Actually, I have no idea if this is keeping up millions of parents up at night, but I thought it was an interesting topic and I thought you would be interested in it, so here we are, I guess. So, today we will dive deep into the research and find out if cannabis use is associated with a decline in IQ and whether there were any components of IQ that were more affected than others. But before I do any of that, I want to talk to you guys about cannabinoids, namely THC or tetrahydrocannabinol and CBD cannabidiol, the two major active ingredients in weed plants. This will be right before I talk about the brains of people who use cannabis frequently and compare those brains to those who don't. As always, you should find links in the description below if you want to read the full science papers yourself. In the description, you should also find chapters in case you want to navigate the different parts of the video that interest you most. I don't expect anyone to have to put up with me for the full duration of this video. But if you find yourself enjoying this video, then I think what's best for both you and me would be for you to subscribe to the channel. Dr. Tell Me Why offers its subscribers weekly science videos about the latest medical research. I also tell you guys about all these fascinating medical conditions and give you top tips on living longer, stronger, and of course healthier. So really no reason not to subscribe, really. So don't forget to smash the like button and let's get started. Question time. How does weed get you high? Well, cannabis contains cannabinoids, the most prevalent being THC, which binds to the CB1 receptors located in the central and the peripheral nervous system. And the activation of CB1 receptors is what is responsible for the highs that are often associated with marijuana use, like euphoria, relaxation, increased appetite, confusion, and sometimes the delusions and hallucinations which some people experience. But THC isn't the only cannabinoid that we find in weed. The second most prevalent cannabinoid is CBD or cannabidiol, which incidentally has the same molecular formulae and a very similar structural formula to THC. Yeah, to THC. There is one small difference, however. THC has a cyclic ring while CBD has an open ring with E-hydroxyl group. And this small difference, well, it has huge consequences, with CBD not being able to bind the CB1 receptors and hence not being able to activate them the same way that THC does. In fact, if you consume CBD alone, you are unlikely to experience any of the highs that are often associated with marijuana use. And actually, CBD works to block the action of THC on the CB1 receptors. CBD plays important roles though, including reducing anxiety, and has been found to be helpful in patients struggling with chronic pain. And it does not appear to affect cognition in the same way that THC does. So how do the brains of those who consume cannabis differ from the brains of those who don't? Two areas of the brain that seem to be remarkably vulnerable to cannabis consumption, at least according to MRI scans, are the hippocampus and the amygdala. The hippocampus more so than the amygdala. Now, the reason why I say they're more vulnerable is that there seems to be a genuinely large amount of research that indicates that these two brain regions tend to be significantly smaller in those who consume cannabis frequently and who started consuming cannabis at a younger age. This is really interesting because the hippocampus just happens to play a really important role in learning and in memory. Yeah, remember that thing I said about people who've used a lot of cannabis having a really bad memory? Yeah, dope. This is made more interesting by the fact that a number of studies were able to show that THC was toxic when applied directly to neurons from the hippocampus using animal models. So much so that there is sufficient evidence to call THC neurotoxic. You can see on the graph how the cell viability declines with time, with the greatest declines observed with the highest concentrations of applied THC. The scientists doing these experiments were actually able to block this to some degree when they administered high doses of either aspirin or vitamin E before adding the THC. So maybe something to consider the next time you feel like having a joint. Though it's unclear whether you would be able to achieve these high concentrations of vitamin E or aspirin under normal circumstances. And finally, the scientists concluded that for THC to be neurotoxic, it actually needed to activate the CB1 receptors. And it just happens to be the case that the hippocampus and the amygdala are particularly rich in CB1 receptors. So, does cannabis result in a decline in IQ? So the study we will be looking at today is a meta-analysis, and if you're wondering what a meta-analysis is, then fear not, I shall heroically explain. A meta-analysis is a study that selects a number of high-quality scientific studies about a specific topic, and then takes the data from these studies to determine if there are any overall trends that arise. And so healthcare professionals and scientists tend to like meta-analysis more than they like individual studies, because meta-analysis tend to only include the studies of the highest quality, and they also tend to have higher sample sizes. And so it's easier to draw conclusions from these studies that you can be more confident about. So back to the video. This meta-analysis included a total of 7 studies from 4 different countries, the UK, the United States, New Zealand, and Canada, bringing the total of participants to 808 cannabis users. And what makes this meta-analysis special is that they only selected studies that measured IQ before that individual started using cannabis, and then later after a set period of time where cannabis was frequently used or abused. And all 7 studies largely agreed with each other, indicating that there was a statistically significant decline in overall IQ of around 1.98 points. Now, it's important to remember that IQ tests have 2 major components. There is a performance IQ, and then there is also a verbal IQ. The verbal IQ component typically measures your capacity to use language to express yourself and understand narrative stories, and tests memory. Meanwhile, the performance IQ assesses your non-verbal skills for solving problem-based scenarios involving symbols and pictures. These two come together to give you your full-scale IQ, and scientists noted that cannabis use did not affect your performance and your verbal IQ in the same way. While verbal IQ was found to decline by 2.94 points, there was no evidence of a decline in performance IQ whatsoever following frequent or dependent cannabis use. Now, a decline of around 2 IQ points on your full-scale IQ, or even 3 IQ points on your verbal IQ, is unlikely to be clinically relevant whatsoever. And I'll say this for extra emphasis, these small declines, though statistically significant, are unlikely to be clinically relevant. However, it should be noted that this pattern of IQ change is remarkably similar to what is observed in schizophrenia, where male patients who later develop the condition are reported to show a drop of around 6 IQ points in their verbal IQ while their performance IQ remains unchanged. This typically happens between the ages of 13 and 17. Hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, then please take the time to smash the like button so YouTube knows that you approve. And if this is your first time watching a Doctor Tell Me Why video, then I recommend you take the time to subscribe to the channel for weekly medical and science videos just like this one. You guys are awesome. Thank you for making it to the end with me, and I love you lots and cannot wait to see you all next week.